Okay, so how to write, huh? How literature shaped me. Okay? So as this is the task for semester four students, huh? That you have to do a group activity, yeah? You have to make a presentation on one contemporary novel, huh? In English language. And while you prepare your presentation, one task that you have to necessarily do is learning outcome, huh? The learning outcome. So what is your learning outcome that you have to talk about when you write about that? So how to write this learning outcome? What do we learn from literature? What do we exactly learn from literature? We can also talk about language, that I'm learning something about language. I'm not only talking about that, I'm learning language, I'm learning about language also. Then I'm learning about society, I'm learning about culture, I'm learning about human beings. And ultimately, I can say I am learning about myself. So the ultimate quest of the learning outcomes of literature is knowing self, is knowing self. How do I know myself in a better way? That is the ultimate goal of reading literature. So when we say how literature shaped me, now that shaping is in terms of understanding self, is in terms of understanding self. So at one level, we can say that, well, literature, I was jealous. Reading literature reduced my jealousy. I was a man of anger. Reading literature reduced my anger. Why? Which literature? That I can talk about. I can give examples. I had these bad things within me. Now reading literature purified, purgated me, or moderated my wild emotions and feelings, or very wild emotions and feelings are moderated, catharsis, all those things also we can say. But in doing that process, what is ultimately important is knowing self. If I know myself, then everything happens. If I don't know, if I deny that, well, I am not like that. I'm not like that. Well, I am Krishna, I am not Duryodhan. As in today's morning, Ramdhari Singh's poem, we were referring to that example. So then there is no chance. There is no chance of killing a Duryodhan within us, killing the Ravan within us, or whether we want to purify all those things. And then we think of shaping self, then is not possible. So knowing self is the primary condition, or the first condition of looking at this. And then we can see how people have thought about it, how people write and think that, how we have lived our life with literature. So two or three examples we will see. One, a particular example of a writer like Arvind Adiga, and how he is narrating his autobiography or his story of growing with literature. That is one. Another is a very general observation about how literature is making its difference. Very simple 4 points. Four points, very general. Adiga's is a particular case. Second example we will see from Brain Pickings will be about more general way of looking at literature. And third is again very, very interestingly humorous article written by one graduate student from Delhi University. And he makes some points very significant and we can relate. We can relate with specifically the study of English literature, not general literatures, but English literature, the study that also we can relate. So in these three aspects, we'll try to see the role of literature in shaping us or knowing us, and then writing about that also. Your task is to see that particular text which you are going to deal, how are you learning from things from that? How is it shaping your ideas, your thinking, your emotions, your feelings, everything that? And then later on, for your digital portfolio, you have to write a full-length write-up about this, wherein you will revisit what you have written as what is literature when you took admission in the department. That is when you were in 2019 June, in the month of June 2019, you wrote something about what is literature. We have preserved that piece of write-up. We will give you back that write-up. So from there, you have to begin. Your writing shall begin from there, that what you thought about literature then, and now you what you are thinking about literature. Is there any addition on that? Is there any better clarity about looking at literature or not? Or whatever way you say, but you will start from that point. So that write-up we will give you, and you will start with that. And then you will say, 5 years of your journey with literature, huh? 3 years of BA and 2 years of master's. In this last 5 years, you have lived with world literature, huh? And how it has shaped you, what kind of modifications, changes, moderation, purification, or enhancement has happened in your life with that. That is what you will write. Some examples, huh? We will see here to see how we can write that. The first thing is we are looking at how Adiga is writing about this. So the link that is given on the blog, from where you will find the full write-up, a few things very quickly we will touch upon that, how he is writing this, and many things you can pick up, many things you can pick up from this write-up by Arvind Adiga when he writes or he speaks about this here. Okay. Just a minute here. I think there is I need to there is a chroma pad. So there are this all settings that we have done in the previous one. Now they are coming back here. Yeah, so let me remove that here. Okay, now it is visible. The full title is now visible. There was some words were being cut down in this case. Okay. So, Arvind Adiga, how English literature shaped me and how he is writing. This we'll see that. So, he comes from Mangalore. Mangalore. So, he writes about Mangalore, the coastal Indian town. Mangalore. The coastal Indian town. Well, Bhavnagar also is a coastal Indian town. So you can relate the things that Bhavnagar also is a coastal Indian town where I lived until I was almost 16. I was almost 16. Is now a booming city of malls and call centers. Now Mangalore has become the city of malls. And so you are having that contemporary way of looking that. In bygone times, like 10 years back, 5 years back, what was the thing and how it has changed there. But in 1980s, it was a provincial town in a socialist country. It was a provincial town in a socialist country. So this that insight of looking at the economy of the country, the politics of the country, everything. The writer is very much aware about when he is writing about shaping through literature. Books were expensive in those days. You say socialist country, but books were expensive. So you see that paradox that comes there. A few of us could actually buy them. Few of us. So he obviously belongs to a higher strata of society. You can't say that he is coming from a very rural, poor background. No, English writer. And all English writers in India obviously have a wonderful background, you can say. A study in English medium school is still privileged. 2 decades back, it was obviously very privileged for a few people only. It was not open for everybody, English medium schools. Now the things are different. But if you don't study in that, and then you can't write literature in English language. So those are very interesting demographic study of writers of India writing. They all are urban, located in urban spaces. The thing to do was to join a circulating library that would lend them out at a nominal rate. So, even though you are still well-to-do family, but still books were expensive. And so if you want to read books, what you used to do is circulating libraries. There is a very interesting concept of circulating library in those years. And even when we were growing, we also were a part of the circulating library. So those were not the years where you used to have a television also in the home, not even radio, television for entertainment. If there was any one program in radio, which I remember from those years, it was coming from this Ceylon station, Ceylon station, and it was Amin Sayani's top 10 songs. Amin Sayani's Bina Ka top 10 Hindi film songs, and people used to glue to radio to listen Amin Sayani and the songs. But then there was what was the entertainment in those years? Well, it was to read. Bina Ka Geet Mala was there. What was entertaining in those years? It was to read comics books. So from where you get the kind of an entertainment. Otherwise, you just have to play something or you have to read these books there. But there is no form of entertainment, no television. Forget about internet and mobile phones or other kinds of things. There were many years to come when that has to happen still. So circulating libraries, few paisa, 15 paisa, 25 paisa, you give and you borrow a book, 2-3 days you read that book. And then again, the person comes on cycle or there is one person who is doing a charity. You go to the home, you exchange the books. And it's very cheap, like few paisa only in which you can do that. So Adiga is recalling this. Now, well, you can recall that when 10 years down the line, when you were 10 years old, 11 years old, 12 years old, what form of reading you were doing? What was your form? Were there newspaper coming in your home? Were there magazines coming in your home? Journals coming, books, television? If it was not there, television obviously was there when you were growing. What was that in television that you were watching? You wanted to watch. Maybe the parents were not allowing, but you wanted to watch those things, cartoons, whatever way. What was that? That can be recorded when you write down this story of shaping of literature. So 5 years are fine of literature, but you can go beyond that and try to connect those things. Like most of my friends in school, I was a member of municipal circulating library. And all of us, to begin with, borrowed and read the same things up to the age of 10. You borrowed comics, mainly illustrated versions of great Indian epics. So there is this Amar Chitra Katha. So even I remember those days of Amar Chitra Katha. So great Indian epics. And then you come to know about the Indian epics, Ramayana, Mahabharata, mythical stories from those comics books, Amar Chitra Katha, which again today also is quite popular and worth reading also. Well, suddenly down the line, you never know that how all these things are going to be useful. You were just reading it for time pass or entertainment. And then you become a student of literature, or you become a teacher of literature, and you realize that all those things are so useful. All those stories of myths are so useful to connect with day-to-day life. And you may be studying English literature, but then the base of Indian mythology helps a lot. It always helps a lot in reading things in variety of ways. Later came your first novels, a boys detective series called The Hardy Boys. The Hardy Boys. So later on, when you grow from one to the another one, then the things are changing. So this write-up is an interesting write-up of as we mature, how our choices keeps on changing. So for example, if you can relate this with that, well, in our childhood, there were no books. But there was television. So what was that you were watching on television? Well, was it He-Man and the Masters of the Universe? So I remember that in the 80s when we had television, and then on Sunday there was one program coming, the He-Man and the Masters of the Universe. And then you wanted to watch that by hook or by crook, by any way. So even if your parents will say, do this, do that, you will do everything. All the works of your parents, of the home, of your homework, everything you will do so that you can watch a particular television program, and that is the Sunday, on Sunday in the morning time, you can watch those things. So here it says Hardy Boys, detective series. Then girls read an equivalent series called Nancy Drew. So there were obviously the gender discrimination that will boys like this, girls like this, and that you will find this distinction even in your homes also. If you have a home where there are boys and girls, in larger number, the better way you can understand that what boys want to watch, what girls want to watch. And then people, there is a sibling war, sibling fight for watching a particular thing on television and those things also. All those things can be noted. All those things can be noted when we sit down to write there. When you grew out of Hardy Boys, you started on the action novels. Huh? When you grew out of Hardy Boys, detective, then action novels. Huh? Alistair MacLean, whose fast-paced novels such as The Guns of Navarone and Where Eagles Dare, well, interesting Hollywood films are made on this. Huh? The Guns of Navarone, a very popular Hollywood film, Where Eagles Dare, again, another interesting film also based on Alistair MacLean, were given glamour by their big budget Hollywood adaptations. My problem started when Alistair MacLean bored me. So, well, we grow and then something starts boring us. So we read literature and then, well, this bores me. Initially, well, Karan Johar's film I loved to watch. Now Karan Johar bores me. You go into the other kinds of realm of watching much darker web series you grow into watching. Relate this with what is your exposure to literature. Don't just go by telling that, well, I had no books and this and that. Well, you had some form of literature around you. It can be local, regional literature also. But whatever it is, how you grew with that. So, well, from there, it says that it bored me. And then the owner of my favorite lending library suggested, my favorite library owner. Now, this is very interesting, Mark also. Librarian suggests. Now, this reminds me that what is the role of a librarian also? The role of a librarian is that he should be interested in all the disciplines, because library is a center for science, commerce, accountancy, all subjects. And he should be interested in all, and he should be suggesting people, teachers and students, that, well, there is something good reading here. You can read this. That is what is the role of a library. It is not only to just safeguard the books or do the clerical work, but the librarian is genuinely interested in libraries and keep on suggesting them. Well, I say this because if you are going to be somewhere in playing a vital role as a librarian or a library or library committee or this or that, this is the function that you can do. The library committee can also pick up this idea, and now you can have a group email, WhatsApp group, and you can start a WhatsApp group or group email or a Facebook page where the library committee keeps on suggesting people that this is worth watching, why it is worth watching, you write a paragraph, this is worth reading, why it is worth reading, you write something, and that can be done. So the idea now, as we are not able to meet but remotely, if the library committee wants to continue, and they can keep a record that how many of them are really doing that, how many of them are really reading what you are suggesting, watching what you are suggesting, that also can be measured by taking follow-up actions about that. Because at the end of the year, you have to prepare tables about how many books are borrowed. Now people are not borrowing books from central library or the department library, so your data may remain empty, and you may have an excuse of corona, but there is a way out. There is still a way out. Librarian's role. Maybe tomorrow you will be working in some school or college, and you are given the task of also managing library. What is the role of library? You have to suggest people, students, and even if they read or not, your role is to suggest. And that is what the librarians are supposed to do. Suggested me that I try a women's writer instead, Agatha Christie. She was fascinating for a while. We know Agatha Christie is one of the widely read writer, one of the best-selling writer of all time, and you will find Agatha Christie there. It will not be Shakespeare. It will be Agatha Christie, as most widely read and the bestseller writer. And she is known for detective novels also. She was fascinating for a while, introducing me to the revolutionary idea about a killer could narrate a novel, the murder of Roger Ackroyd, before she bored me too. For a couple of years, it was great to read Agatha Christie also. The librarian then gave me, and then I bored out of those things. And we very quickly bore out from several such forms of write-up or reading or watching also. The librarian then gave me an edition of Complete Plays of Oscar Wilde, an edition which excluded Salome. You can say why this is given in this bracket. That also can be your quest or question to find out. Then he had nothing more for me The next place I went to was my grandfather's house. Then library was okay, that was done. Anything that was good in library was read, you know, touched upon by him. And now he says, I went to grandfather's house. In cupboards, its cupboards were full of dusty books, all in English. Well, if you have a grandfather who had a cupboard and his cupboard was full of books, and that also in English language, obviously you belong to a very elite family, a very elite. Imagine your grandfather. Imagine your grandfather and your grandfather's book collection. And perhaps you may find that, well, nothing like book. Perhaps nothing. If there are books in your grandfather's collection, not father's collection, in your grandfather, then, well, you are very fortunate. You are coming from a family which is hardly 1% in India. Hardly 1% families in India. Such an elite family you are. But look into it. Look into it. Go back and make an inventory of the family, that what was the culture of reading, and then what kind of books they were reading. You may perhaps find only religious books. Perhaps only religious books. If there are philosophical books also, you should be great enough that, well, your grandparents were thinkers. They were reading something that was challenging. Well, but here it was all in English language. Now imagine Erwin Edgar's grandfather, almost the British Raj time, and you are there having a good collection of these books. This surprised me, because my grandfather, an Indian nationalist, freedom struggle, Indian nationalist, disdained to speak English, except to correct other men's. So he was surprised. My grandfather was a nationalist, and he wanted to have that love for mother language, which becomes a part of nationalism also. That's why we say that this attraction for mother language, or the very idea, is connected with the concept of nationalism also. Freedom struggle is at the root of everything. Now, when you are out of the very idea of freedom struggle, when you don't have to fight with the other, now it is all yours. Now it is all yours. And that is why we need to change the concept of looking at English language also, which even Adiga is referring here. So he was surprised at this. He was a prominent local lawyer who dressed in hand and this. Handspun cloth, so Gandhian ideal. So you are very much the follower of Gandhian ideals. You do hand spinning on charkha, and then you will prepare your own cloths. Spoke only the local language, and that was Kannada. So Adiga's mother language or local language from where he comes is Kannada, and scorned anything Western. Anything Western is to be scorned at, is to be disdained at. Except for the one occasion when he had come out of his law office to chide me, to scold me in precise English. That was, you cannot put a gate. You cannot put a gate. Now this put a gate is a phrase which normally do not find Indians speak there. Remember the expression? Batti Ram Karide. Batti Ram Karidevi. Atle Batti Bujavi Devi. Yes. Batti Bujavi Devi. That is Batti Ram Karidevi. Batti Bujavi Devi. That is how it says. Now that is very much a Kathiawadi expression. And then you realize, well, this is very much a Kathiawadi way of putting the things there. This is his put a gate. I had never heard him speak the language. My other grandfather, surgeon, this other grandfather is surgeon and belonged to the opposite school of thought. Once refusing to attend an official dinner in honor of the president of India, Zail Singh, on the grounds that the president's English was inadequate. The another side of the grandfather was diehard fan of English language, and Jail Singh was not able to speak proper English, so he denied having a dinner. Now, we also come to know that Adiga obviously belongs to a very elite group, like Salman Rushdie also belonged to a very elite group of writers who had got different kinds of childhood with literature, English language, and that's why they are able to write creatively in that language. Such debates were dead for my generation. Such debates of this language, this nationalism, that this father, that father, this grandfather, that debate is dead for my generation. What my grandparents called the King's English or Queen's English, the refined one, the British accent and all those kinds of thing, I call Nehru's English. I call for me, Nehru was one of the best speaking, English speaking person when he is growing. So you are, obviously it is not, Nehru is already passed away when Adiga is coming. Adiga is still not very old person. So, but you were studying about Nehru, and Nehru was in the air. So Nehru's English, Nehru's writing and everything. Today we can say any such people who is having a good English language, then it is Shashi Tharoor. Shashi Tharoor, we have lots of memes about his command over vocabulary, his command over English language that we have. So when you write this after a few years, you can say, well, for us, it was Shashi Tharoor's English language, which people used to talk a lot about when you say this. Yes, Mehal has shared that link from where you will find this also. The Prime Minister's great speeches in English, the Tryst with Destiny, oration delivered on India's independence, 1947. The light has gone out of our lives to announce Gandhi's death, or rather we can say murder, to the nation the next year. We're taught in school, quoted on radio, and their fragments were found like DNA strands in old newspapers and magazines. So Nehru's English language, Nehru's speeches was everywhere widespread. Today we can say Narendra Modi, the Prime Minister's language, the speeches, the rhetoric, though not English language, but the Hindi language or the Gujarati language, it is widespread in all similar ways there. But he's speaking about English language here, and Nehru was the master writer. Nehru could only have made these speeches in English. Nehru could have, and that is where he makes this interesting reference, could have made these speeches only in English. Because had he spoken in Hindi, we in the south of India, Kannada writer, where Hindi is not spoken and is often abhorred, would not have understood him. Every foundational document of India was known to me only in English. And what are those documents? The Constitution, for instance, and even Gandhi's autobiography, were written in his native Gujarati, but taught in school in an English translation. So here we hear importance of English in India. As a passing remark, Adhika is also making that reference that why this English language is a lingua franca or a connecting language, that North and South, the West and the East, all are connected with this language. Otherwise, it will be nearly impossible to read all these writers. How could we function without our only common language? Doing away with English seemed to me tantamount to doing away with India. We were the languages before the language was ours. We were the language. You are born in 70s, 1970s or 1980s. Well, you are born in 1990s, later part of 1990s. And you find that English language was already there at that time. So we were of languages before the language was ours. So most of you, when you were, might have been born, the first thing that people would have asked was whether baby che ke babo che, the English words, the baby word would have been asked or pronounced when we were born. So language was already there, the English language in different form, even before we became the languages. Kannada, the South Indian language that is in Indian terms, my mother tongue, which means generally that your father speaks it. That is that pun on this idea, the father speaks it, that is patriarchal way of looking at the language, has produced one of the world's great literatures. Kannada has produced great literature, and then he refers, and you can connect here with Gujarati literature. When you write, you can say something about Gujarati literature. Says great, and but of its poets and writers, only one, the novelist U.R. Anantamurthy, regarded by some as India's greatest living novelist, broke through to me, and only because one of his books had been adapted for the cinema. I rarely saw any of my middle class classmates read a Kannada book out of the classroom, where we were forced to learn poems and prose extracts in the lifeless way, reinforced with violence, typical of provincial Indian education in 1980s. The condition of this education in provincial India is still similar. It's not very much changing as such. But this, that you are Anant Murthy, the only Kannada writer that you were aware about, was also because film Sanskar, Girish Karnad made a film Sanskar out of the novel Sanskar, written by U.R. Anantamurthy. So you also got exposed to your own mother language, great literature in that, through cinema. Now, this is what you can equate with Dhruv Bhatt and film Rewa. Dhruv Bhatt was there very much for quite a long time, but how many of the Gujaratis were reading Dhruv Bhatt? But when a cinema is made out of that, a film Rewa is made from Tattvamasi, then the things changed about Dhruv Bhatt, and lots of people started reading Dhruv Bhatt also. So that is the connection that you can make, and many other things you can see into those things also. All the glamour was in English. Maybe perhaps for most of you, I don't know whether the glamour was in English or not when you were growing. Except for your childhood was in English medium school, or you were surrounded by English films or English cartoons or English books. Anyway, then perhaps you may see the thing. Otherwise, perhaps normally the things might have written that is regional. So if you are growing into a rural provincial Gujarat, remotely located villages, then perhaps you may not be exposed to Hollywood cinema also. In those years, you may not be able to go to theater, or you may not be able to get access to those in your television also. You can't watch, you can't imagine to watch a Hollywood film with your family members. So I don't think anybody, even if there was television there, you might have ever watched a Hollywood film with the family members in the home. Well, mobile gives lots of scope to watch all kinds of stuff, but well, not on a television a screen. And when you were growing, there was no mobile also. Mobile is still like last 3-4 years only. So even in those years, you may not be exposed to those things. Now, this, all those things are to be noted. This all should be noted, documented, that this is how the life was. And because the life has changed very fast, it becomes very interesting to observe those phases. So just within 5 years, lot many things have changed with literature, with cinema, with our exposure to the world, Imagine 5 years back, what was our exposure to the world? It was not that significant as it is today. So this is what he says, that Kannada, well, great literature, great work, but what are people doing? Are they reading the regional literatures or not? Perhaps not. Not many people are interested in those things. All the glamour was there, and Alistair MacLean, then Desmond Bagley, Jeffrey Archer, he refers. Now were there many Indian writers of serious English literature? I could find one except for, nor were there many writers, Indian writers of serious English literature. I could find none except for R.K. Narayan, who seemed our only contender in the big ring. Two Indians known to have written important works of non-fiction were both tainted by the popular feeling that they were unpatriotic, Nirad Chaudhary and V.S. Naipaul. So if you have two good writers in English, then you say these are anti-nationals. He used the word unpatriotic. Now we use the word anti-national, or we use the word urban national very easily for this thing. But here it was unpatriotic. I stayed away from that, and this is what he says about this. Patriotism was also involved in lot many this thing. America has also supported Pakistan in 1971 war that created Bangladesh, and our foreign policy was sympathetic towards Soviet Union, Russia, rather than America. So if you love your country, you hate America. If you love your country, you hate America, and you love Russians. Now the things have changed drastically. Today we are not so much near Russia, but we are very much near America. Today, talking favorably about America is good, is considered patriotic. The British had resigned all interest in India in 1947 and seemed to count for nothing in world politics now. So they were a neutral nation, as far as I was concerned, and their writers soon provided the bulk for my reading. So, Darwin, Tennyson, and many such writers from the Britain coming, G.K. Chesterton, G.B. Shaw, J.B. Priestley, Somerset Maugham, and you also have a lots of collection of British writers, because our syllabus by and large in UG, PG is all about British writers and also about American writers along with that, but you don't find much of Russian writer, Canadian writer, Chinese writer, many other you won't find in those syllabuses also, or whatever you have studied also. Science and mathematics were highly valued. Even today they are. Science and mathematics were highly valued. And this also can be the point that you can note it down, that when you were moving from your school days into 11th and 12th, and if you're moving towards science or towards the common stream, general stream, or from that, whether you are moving towards arts and towards other people going towards engineering, medicine, what was happening? What kind of language was around you? How were you looked upon? How were you looked by the people who surrounded you when you were selecting arts, or when you were going for this? So that all also is something that you can write it down when you write this. Show this science and this weather. Show exciting and edgy yet completely profanity free. Okay, I'm skipping that part. For every novel, I read a dozen magazines. So again, now when you go back to the magazines, what kind of magazines are popular in Gujarati? You can say Chitralekha, Gruh Shobha, and Safari magazines. So what are those popular magazines, and are you reading those or not? Or there are supplements, newspaper supplements. Every day there is a supplement. Monday there is this, Tuesday there is another one, Wednesday. So each and every day is a specific thing. For like Friday is for cinema, then Monday is for technology. Now people have started having one day for the technology supplements. One day is for Nari. Tuesday, I think, is for Nari. And so there are women kinds of things there. Wednesday is for general literature is there. Sunday and Wednesday, 2 days supplements are full of literature works also. Lots of poems or short stories or Navalika things, and some write-ups on that also is going on. So maybe you are reading some kinds of serial novels or something in local newspapers that can be noted down here. You can note down those things also here. Yeah, Shatadal and Ravi Purti and all the newspapers have all those kinds of things there. Are you asking your friends that which supplements you are reading? And if one is reading Divya Bhaskar, another is reading Sandesh, another third one is Gujarat Samachar, do you still sometimes exchange all those things? People can't afford to subscribe for all the newspapers. If they cannot afford to subscribe, then our people keep on sharing. They make their own circulating library about newspapers, write-ups, some good write-ups, and people share or not. What kind of sharing do we do among our friends, our relatives, our like equal age people, not only the classmates, but the other people also, we are connected with society. So what kind of things do we share? Do we tell them that watch this web series? Well, fine, we also tell them that watch this web series. We share the link of web series on social media and other places. Also, that can be can also be seen into that. So all those things that we do in and around about literature in our life, that sharing, what kind of stuff? Note it down, those things. And Adiga has done very, very significantly in few words. He has told us, given us an idea to work in all these things with. So he says this, dozen magazines, if we had little literature by Indians and English, we had a mountain of top rate journalistic writing. The office of my grandfather, the one who had not speak the language, overflowed with English language. Man is making a fun or a pun of his satire of his grandfather also, that who wanted to abhor English language, but lots of magazines used to come in his office. India Today, Sunday Frontline, the Illustrated Weekly of India, famous names, many of them are still alive today. Then as in the case now, India's best journalists routinely used English with a directness and power that few of our novelists can match. And I owe much to the editors of these magazines. Two of them, Khushwant Singh and M.J. Akbar, are still prolific. So Khushwant Singh, who passed away recently, MJ Akbar is still alive, facing Me Too allegations now, MJ Akbar, but then prolific journalistic writing. Now we can say journalism and creative writing, it opens that window. And you will find that even writers like Hemingway, they were also journalists. Ernest Hemingway has done lots of journalistic writing also, and he got that style of simplicity from the journalistic writing. So that way, that it's not like journalism is lower, it can be people write. There is Tarun Tejpal, another writer, Tarun Tejpal, Tehelka.com. Tarun Tejpal also facing lots of cases about Me Too and sexual abuse kind of a thing. Maybe he's in prison or out, I don't know right now, but there are allegations against him. He also is a good writer of novels in recent times. So this journalism and write-ups, and you can pick up about some Gujarati writers also if you find the parallel. Around this time, I began pulling out of municipal library books that seemed some darker, more disturbing. Then after this time, I'm maturing, and then we go move towards darker and disturbing kind of things there. Animal Farm, Dr. Foster's, Edgar Allan Poe, these are all the part of your syllabus also. More darker, more disturbing kind of thing. Well, perhaps you may say, well, I was not at all disturbed by all this thing. It was not at all touching me anywhere that I was disturbed by the narratives of Dr. Foster's or Animal Farm or Edgar Allan Poe. Well, then can be the question that why? Why are, in a way, we are not being disturbed by such a write-up? That also can be the question, that how deeply do we take the things that we read, then we are disturbed or something happens. But when I was about 15, I found a book so dark and mysterious that it seemed to annul everything that I had read until then. And that was William Golding's Lord of the Flies. William Golding's Lord of the Flies, which seemed to me the first book of my maturity. Which is your first book of your maturity? Which is your first web series of your maturity or a film of your maturity, which you think that, well, this has, I have grown to understand this. I have grown to understand this. I begin looking for others like it, even asking an uncle in America to send me the Lord of the Rings in the hope that it would be similar. Lord of the Rings, because this is Lord of the Flies. Lord of the Rings, thinking that it would be similar, but no. Lord of the Rings is a kind of a children's literature. Lord of the Rings, and there are films made on Lord of the Rings also. But it was not so. It was not at all similar to Lord of the Flies. I was desperate to have this novel sent soon because I knew my times as a reader of novels was almost at an end. I would soon be studying to become a doctor. The only career that other than being an engineer opened to middle class boy in a small town in those years. The situation by and large are even today, doctor or engineer in a way. After that, I would be practicing medicine like my father and uncles, and my novels would end up in a wooden case for my grandson to discover. Then all at once, as these things tend to happen, the world came to end. My mother was dead and I was taken out of Mangalore and India. Suddenly the things started changing. The world has flooded in Mangalore. This is the last paragraph. Here it says, the world has flooded now today. Then he went abroad and he studied out of India. The other education happened out of India. And he occasionally keeps on coming to India and stays at different places. Then now he says that now, today, what is Mangalore? This was the Mangalore of my childhood, and I have grown in Mangalore with all these books and libraries and the things. Now, the world has flooded into Mangalore. India's great economic boom, the arrival of the internet and outsourcing have broken the walls between provincial India and the world. Indian-born novelists such as Salman Rushdie and Amitav Ghosh have exorcised Priestley and Tennyson for good from the bookshelves of even the remotest Indian town. So even in those towns now, people do not read J.B. Priestley or Tennyson, but they are interested in Salman Rushdie, Jhumpa Lahiri, many women writers also, Jhumpa Lahiri, Amitav Ghosh, and obviously later on Chetan Bhagat and a kind of popular writers of the 21st century. Yet I am glad that having been raised in the ancient regime, Mangalore's libraries, though cut off from the world, did supply me a set of very fine writers whose books amplified the central message of Nehru's English. And what was that Nehru's English, the message? And see the pun, the satire on that Nehru's very idea about socialism and everything. And he says Nehru's English that the world was a place full of light, and if spoken to in a rational language, would respond it one. This is what we see in terms of what Paulo Coelho says, that if you think something, if you very deeply desire to achieve something, the universe will design that, make a design that you achieve those kinds of things. Kisi cheez ko badi shiddat se chaho, to puri kainat aapko usko milane ki. So all those kinds of Bollywood is kind of a thing that we find here. That is what he says Nehru's English told us. That the world was a place full of light. World is a place full of light. And if spoken to in a rational language, would respond in one. If you will be hopeful, light means hopeful, optimistic to the world. And then you will get hope and optimism. It is light everywhere in the world. That is what he said. And see the last line. His novel, The White Tiger, is not about this hope. It is not about this optimism. So he said, last line, this is, of course, not really true. This is, of course, not really true. And had I grown up in a big city, I would have known it from the start. I've grown in Mangalore, a smaller town. So I realized it much later on. If I had grown in a bigger town, I would have realized it much earlier that there is a different world. There is India of darkness and there is India of light also. And there is a huge difference between these two Indias of this. Mangalore is still a better place than Bhavnagar. Bhavnagar is more a darker space. And then if you go down into the mountain plains around Palitana or Jaisar or in the villages of Pithalpur and Tana and other kinds of things, there is more of a darkness there. But how the people living there, when I was looking at the geolocations that you have shared, and many of you have still a problem of just having a presentation from your location, how dark the space is, how dark the space that we live, but how do we realize that I'm living in darkness? Unless I go to a better space, unless I go to a larger space, and unless I see the things from a top, if I climb somewhere, then only I can say, well, there is a darkness there. And I was staying in the darkness for so many years. And then I realized, so he said that, well, Nehru told that you, everything is light, you speak in the light and everything. No, it is not going to be. The world is more darker. So that is what, when you read Dr. Foster's, when you read Edgar Allan Poe, when you read Animal Farm, when you read 1984, George Orwell, and many, many such writers, in that way, then we realize what Adiga has also realized. And from there comes the novel like The White Tiger. Okay? So that is about Adiga, how he is writing, and gives, I hope you might have got many interesting examples from this. Okay, any further thing that you would like to ask or add here right now, anything before I move to the another piece of writer? Okay, I think that you got an idea about several things randomly, what you can do when you sit down to write for your digital portfolio.
Okay? Yes, sir. Clear.
Yeah, okay. So the next one that we want to see, for this, let me share a screen. What books do for the human spirit? A more general way of looking at it. Okay? Coming out from Adiga's very personal space of how literature shaped himself, from there to what literature is supposed to do normally or generally. The four psychological functions of great literature. Uploaded on the School of Life. School of Life is a very interesting platform. There is a YouTube channel also. And they keep on uploading small, beautiful videos worth watching there. This we have taken from the source. Let me share the screen. Yeah, this is the resource, brain pickings. Brain pickings is the resource from where we have taken this. Okay? And here, this link, you will get it from the blog. Our main blog has this link also. What books do for the human spirit? Yeah? The four psychological functions of great literature. Writers open our hearts and minds and give us maps of our own selves. And give us maps of our own self. Map is something where we know the things, how to go, how to move on. very important. When you see map as a metaphor for connecting with the self, is very important that when you see the map, it doesn't mean that the plains will be good terrain. If the terrain is rough, it will still remain rough. If there are mountains will still remain mountains, and ocean will remain ocean, and the hardship on the roads will remain hardships. It is not all going to be very smooth if you know. The same is the case about self. Even if I know myself, it is not possible for me to change everything about me. I can't change everything about me. But I can realize that these are my limitations. This is what I can't do. That also is what mapping self. That is how you can see. So, four points, that is a small video also. And this 4 point, the first one is, it saves you time. It saves you. Now, this is a very, very, very paradoxical statement. Like, reading literature is wastage of time. For many people, reading literature is wastage of time. People say, well, I want to watch or read, but I don't have time. I have business to do. I have some work to be done. So, well, literature is a time pass activity. When I am free, I do that. I don't spare time out of something for that. But whenever I am free, people say, watch this web series. Well, when I will be free, I will watch it. Well, it means that you are not taking it seriously. It is not taken seriously in that context there. So it is paradoxical. It saves time. So what is that context? It says it saves time. It looks like it's wasting time, but literature is actually the ultimate time saver because it gives us access to a range of emotions and events that it would take you years, decades, millennia to try to experience directly. Literature is the greatest reality simulator. Literature is the greatest reality simulator. Reality simulator. A machine. Literature is a machine that puts you through infinitely more situations than you can ever directly witness. The other day we were talking about just a minute. I think in the other class I will have a class. So let me just put a message to the students in the other class. Okay. Okay, it is 2:15 time. I think the people will come here afterwards. Okay. Students here. In semester one, I am talking with the semester one students. My class is still going on in semester three. So either you can join that class or you will be free today. Either if you want to attend, then you can join semester four class by that link. Or it will be, I will keep this on here also. I will keep this on. So those who are joining later on, they also get the signal that your class is postponed today. I'm conducting a class in semester four. So this class, I'm keeping this on here in the semester one also, but you can put a message or you can inform the latecomers that the other class, I'm talking with semester four students right now. Okay. If you want to, you can continue staying there. Otherwise, because we are talking about some general topic there about literature. So if you want to, you can continue. Semester one students can also continue attending the class here. Okay? Okay, so coming back to semester four, it saves you time. We're talking about machine. The time machine is an idea, but it is not achieved. Well, literature is the real time machine. You can go as back as 5,000 years back when you read Mahabharata, and thousands years back when you read myths. From there, you can go to America, you can go to Africa, you can explore the entire world and their cultures without being with them, without going at all. There you can explore those things. When you read British literature, the culture, when you know so many things about Christianity also that many times even Christians don't know. Many times even Christians or those people who travel this world, you are better knowledgeable about that world than the people who actually go there. Those who go there, they are not aware about those cultures, the more you know, because you have traveled through through literature. So literature is a time machine which gives you an exploration of lot many cultures and other things. Apart from that, what happens when we do that? We mature in emotions, in feelings. In this. So earlier we said that the students of literature are at least 20 years more mature than their age. They are more mature. That is what the point comes here. And this is psychologically, it says that. It makes you nicer. It makes you, now this is problematic. Again, like the first one was problematic. This also is problematic. That, well, nicer means what? Will I be very good? Now, we know that good people are screwed very, very quickly in this world. So being good means you will be on a suffering end. Being good is you are on a suffering end. So, well, you can't be so good that anybody can exploit you emotionally, physically, monetarily, anyway. So what is this being nicer? It is not only to wear a smiling face and do whatever other people wants you to be done. No, that is not the nicety of the people. So that is where literature performs the basic magic of what things look like through someone else's point of view. It allows us to consider the consequences of our actions on others in a way we otherwise wouldn't. And it shows us examples of kindly, generous, sympathetic people. Literature deeply stands opposed to the dominant value system, the one that rewards money and power. Writers are on the other side. They make us sympathetic to ideas and feelings that are of deep importance but can't afford airtime in a commercialized, status-conscious and cynical world. And this is very important, the second para. So it really tells us that, well, with whom should I stand? I should stand with the one who is helpless, who is poor, who is downtrodden. If I have a capacity to write a poem, I should write about the emotions of those who cannot express their emotions. If I have a capacity to make a film or a cinema, then I should make a cinema about those who are not in a position to make a cinema about themselves. I should tell a story of those people who are not in a position to tell their stories. I should write about them. That is what literature teaches. That is to be nice. That is, it is not to be nice to power in any way. So there are mighty powers. Religion is a mighty power. Politics, people in the power in politics are mighty, mighty people. So it is not to make a film about the people who are powerful. It is not to sing the songs of religion, which is already so powerful. It is about the other people who are exploited by religion. And that is what you will see in Da Vinci Code also. Da Vinci Code, when you will see that, you will understand that also in a significant way. So that is being nice. Nice is being understanding to whom we should be sympathetic. To whom we should be sympathetic. That is being nice. Now, many times we see that people are sympathetic towards very powerful people. And we are really surprised that, no, it is not possible. We are not taught to be sympathetic towards powerful people. We are supposed to be sympathetic towards the people who are not enjoying a kind of a roshni, or who are enjoying ras garba, or very much into a very good clothes and very very much in a sukoon. But those people who are on the roads, don't have clothing, there's bitter winter going on, and they are resisting against something. So people, literature will say that being nice is to be with those people. Is to be with those people. It is as simple as this. Now there is no need to tell that. Well, this is what literature is all about. So when people sometimes you argue that why you take this side or that, well, you say that, well, that is what literature is all about. You are genuinely student of literature, a teacher of literature. You read literature, and if you don't do this, well, obviously you are not that what you are supposed to be. Psychological advantages of reading literature. This does this happen or not? Do we our approaches change towards looking at the thing? And how do we look at our approaches being changed? We have to see that when we are growing with our siblings, with our brothers and sisters, with our friends, now suddenly if you find that you think that you look at the world in a much different way than your parents, your relatives, your siblings, your old friends are looking at it, that difference will tell you that, well, literature has played a vital role. No? But if there is no difference, obviously you're not going to do it. It's not going to happen, huh, with that kind of thing then. So today, when I look back in my school days, the people who went into science, then commerce, then management, and then economics, and different kinds of professions they are doing, well, I can really find a clear-cut distinction in our thinking now. I can't think like most of them, the way they tend to look at the thing. It is not possible for me to look, and there are lots of conflict of ideas that keep on happening on either side of the thing. Well, I say it is because of this. It is because of literature that it has its own psychological impact. It's a cure for loneliness. Now that obviously we can understand, it's a cure for loneliness and other things are there. We are weirder than we like to admit. We are very weird people. Well, that's why we said earlier that now people say that WhatsApp or Facebook, but even when it was not there, the people who were readers, they were almost like that only. Because for them, there was a different world altogether. Their world was always a different one. They were always living with imaginary people. They were always living with imaginary characters. And they were more dear to them than the living beings. And when we are glued to the book, you don't like to talk with the people. You don't like to talk. And so people would love to snatch away a book from your hand. And we know earlier people were not allowing women to read books also, because they say that, well, the women will not concentrate in their household work. Tom Jones was lost on a railway station. The child was lost because the nurse, the Aya, the keep, was lost in reading a novel, was hiding a novel in the baggage where the child was sleeping, that she used to hide, and she was sitting on a railway station or somewhere, and then just lost into the novel in such a way that the boy is lost. Now, what do we read from that? That, well, reading novel is dangerous. Reading novel is dangerous. And if the women will read, it is more dangerous. You will not be sincere towards your duties. So weirder people. Literature makes people very weird in that sense. We often can't say what's really on our minds. We can't often say that. But in books, we find descriptions of who we genuinely are and what events describes with an honesty quite different from what ordinary conversations allow for. In the first books, it's as if the writer knows us better than we know ourselves. So this is writers open our hearts and minds and give us maps of our own selves so that we can travel in them more reliably and with less of a feeling of paranoia and persecution. And the fourth final one, it prepares you for failure. It prepares us for failure in life. And so when we study philosophy like existentialism, we realize that, well, pain and agony, sorrows and suffering is an integral part of life. Whether you do anything or not, that is going to happen. It is bound to happen. It's a part of life. It is not like you are a sinner, so that is happening to you. It is not that you are a papi, so coronavirus is coming to you. No, it is not so. Coronavirus is not to a kind of a revenge mechanism of nature or a divine power. No, it is not a revenge mechanism. That it has come to take a revenge upon papis. And so divine wanted to kill the papi. And so there are, America is full of papis. And so many people are dying in America. No, it is not so. Sorrows, suffering are an integral part of life. You don't see in that way that it is this or that. You see the things in a much different way. You don't see this simple thing like haramni kamani hospital ma samani. Haramni kamani hospital ma samani. So no, it is not so. It is all people get illness. Illness is something different. Accidents happen. People do have a suffering of different kinds. Cancers, diabetes, lots of diseases are hereditary. Even if you are very good, then also those kinds of things happen. You can't say that, well, illness is a result of sin. No, absolutely. No, you can't see the things in the same way. So in the same way, failures or the thing also happen. It is not that because I forgot to do prayer in the morning, so my paper was bad. No, it is not so. I didn't do this. I didn't do that mantra. I have not completed that mantra, so I am not passing in interview, so I am not getting a job. Well, no, it's not so. Literature says that no, failure is a part of life. It is an integral part of the things are there. All of our lives, one of our greatest fears is the failure of messing up, of becoming, that tabloid puts it, a loser. Every day the media takes us into a stories of failure. Interestingly, a lot of literature is all about failure. In one way or another, a great many novels, plays, poems are about people who messed up. Great books don't judge as harshly as or as one-dimensional as the media, journalism, this positive attitude, people, self-help culture, the way they look, great literatures don't look at that way. They don't see the things in a similar way. So literature deserves its prestige for one reason above all others, because it's a tool to help us live and die with a little bit more wisdom, goodness, and sanity. Yeah? That is where it becomes very significant to look at literature. Now, our concern obviously is that any of those things really happened to us or not. Whether all these things are happening to us or not. That is our question. People say, આ તો લોકોએ વાત કરી કે આવું આવું થાય, પણ મારી સાથે શું? 5 years of literature, every day we get to know about some literature. What is happening to us? That is my honest question that I have to ask to myself. A particular text that you are going to study, you can ask this question about that also. That what is happening? Is that what is fulfilled or not? You can say, no, it is not fulfilling. There is no problem about it. You can say, no, there is something else. You can find something new thing. Also, not only following this that is given here, but these are the guidelines which becomes very necessary to look into it. Okay, I hope you got the idea. Second point about generally about literature. 4 psychological advantages that they try to say are this that happens with literature. Third point. The third one is... The final third one is this, a very interesting write-up. Is BA English in India just time pass? Is BA English in India just time pass? Well, by and large, to many people, it is so. To many people, it is so. And that is why, you find so many students doing BA just for a time pass, or just they do their GPSC exam preparations. And then they join BA. Why? Because BA is time pass. BA is meaningless, whether you do or not. But you want a graduate. You want minimum graduate to appear in GPSC, UPSC exam. So I am doing this. Now, this means that BA has no value. It means BA arts has no value at all. It is not a good sign. When people very proudly say that so many UPSC, GPSC pass people are arts graduates. Well, I say it is not a good sign for arts. It is a bad sign for arts, because they took it the easiest way to be graduate. They took it as the easiest way to be graduate. They found that science is difficult, commerce is difficult, arts is the easiest one. That's why they have selected that. It is not something to be proud of. Is BA in India just time pass? Well, absolutely you will find. So, but then how you find an answer, other answer to the alternative way of looking at this? And so this was a very interesting write-up written by, Krishna. Krishna is the writer of this. It puts things in a very interesting way here. Okay. Some of the important thing that is given here are like this. I'm reading a few part of that. You have a link if you want to open. This is the starting of this write-up. See the starting, the very first line of this. It says, it is truth universally acknowledged that a person studying English literature as a formal course isn't really studying. Do you remember any work of literature when you read this line?
Yes, sir. Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice, the opening lines. It is universally acknowledged that the single man in search of a good fortune must be in want of a wife.
Yeah, exactly. So see how that learning of literature is used by this writer when he's writing. Yeah, how that is used so interestingly. And you find, well, this writer is a very good student of literature. So when you write down something, how do you connect that with literature? Whatever you write, it is not about literature, it is about something else. But still, how that literary touch comes, that the people, when they read, they find that, well, you are a student of literature. This we can see among lawyers, among judges also. Yeah, judges, Supreme Court na judge, emna nivedan aapta hoy, ane jo emne sahitya bhaina hoy, to sahitya aavya vagar rahe j nahi. Hai na, observation ma sahitya na aave tevu bane j nahi. That is the impact of literature. But with our graduate students or our postgraduate students also, we don't find literature coming up so easily, so quickly. The literature that they study, it rarely comes. It doesn't become the style of writing. Then we are gravely concerned that what is happening? Why are students, BA or MA, they are not looking at literature so seriously? And so we have to do some thinking activity. We have to train them. We have to orient them. We have to tell them that write something. Write what is literature. And then after 2-3 years, visit back and see again, write again what is literature and try to see the literature from this perspective, so that you become alert, you become aware about it. But how many of you will become alert and aware out of 27? Hardly 15 or 17 at the most. I would say they would become alert and write this. Many of you will just cut copy paste from previous students. Many of you will cut copy paste or will not be able to write meaningfully. At the end of the day in semester 4, when we will see digital portfolio, we will read your write-ups. We will read your write-ups in your presentations. Also, we will see how you are talk about this. And we want this style. So there is a text that is given, like Da Vinci Code or White Tiger or The Sense of an Ending is given to you, Harry Potter. Now, can you pick up some of the style when you write about this? That also will be very interesting if that also happens. Not very easy. But still, you can try it out to use the literary expressions for your day-to-day writing. Okay? So that is whenever an Indian boy decides to offend his parents, this is a very dark humor, Dickensian humor. Adiga also has that dark Dickensian humor. A boy offend his parents and ruin the toil of an entire lifetime and do an English course in Delhi University College, it is knowingly accepted as a step into the bottomless pit of aimlessness, unemployment, and inebriations. So this kid who is going for the arts in, for example, we can say Shamal Das College, now, what is the future of that student? Bottomless pit into aimlessness and unemployment. What is the scope of these students? Perhaps no scope that lies there. No jobs, no future, no wife. So that is how it tries to put it. It is in this backdrop that a student of English literature in DU starts his journey. When you start your journey of BA, it is almost, and many of you, if there are more number of boys, they will more relate with this. Girls doing BA is good enough. It is a good status. But for the boys, it is not so. And this write-up is written by a boy. Yeah? And that also, the gender plays a very vital role in this discrimination. And why boys also will have to fight with patriarchy? Because this burdens boys a lot. Patriarchy is a burden on boys. And there is something else expected from boys when they study. They can't study the things that they like also. That also is an influence of patriarchy. So the fight with patriarchy is not only for the women. It is also for men also. They have to fight with patriarchy. So he says that when you do this, the journey will start, will last 3 years. It is taken for granted that he will read novels and waste time. It is taking, he read novel, vartao vaatse. Ghana loko kehta ke tamare hoy shu vartao hoy ke. Ane ghana loko khare khara agla divse varta vaachi ne pariksha lakhi aave. Ane toy pacha pass thai ne aavi che. Toy pacha pass thai varta j na khabar hoy. Agla divse mitra ne puchhu hoy ke varta kahi de. Varta kahi ne jain lakhi na avtare. So how lightly we also take this wasting time. The first challenge is the transition from the space of a school to the college campus. The campus is a socio-cultural hospice. It is an amalgamation of pop culture and semi-rebellion. There is every kind of individual, the intellectual, the inebriate, the local cosmopolite, the jolla totting revolutionary. There is no uniform. There is barely an institution-imposed discipline. So you suddenly go into an openness of something. Suddenly you feel the fresh air of liberty and freedom once you enter in this. Well, many schools and many colleges now are run by school administrators. अबे स्कूल चलावनारा लोको जो जारे कॉलेज शुरू करे એટલે ડ્રેસ કોડ પણ આવી જાય એમાં યુનિફોર્મ પણ આવી જાય યુનિફોર્મ આવે એટલે પછી બધું સ્કૂલ જેવું જ લાગે કોલેજ જેવું લાગે જ નહીં વોટ ઇઝ ઇટ ટુ બી ઇન કોલેજ ઇન યુનિવર્સિટી એઝ વી ટોક મેની ટાઈમ ઇટ ઇઝ ધીસ ધેટ યુ ધીસ પીપલ લેક્ચ્યુઅલ લોકલ કોસ્મોપોલાઇટ જોલા ટોટલિંગ રિવોલ્યુશનરી નો યુનિફોર્મ એન્ડ ઇન્સ્ટિટ્યુશન ઇમ્પોઝ્ડ ડિસિપ્લિન ઇઝ ઓલમોસ્ટ એબસન્ટ ઇટ ઇઝ ઓલમોસ્ટ absent here. The teacher don't want silence. The teachers don't want classes either. However, they are highly learned individuals and there is much to learn from them. The concept of education itself is altered. Knowledge has to be extracted rather than absorbed. So this is very interesting that if you are more curious, then you go and you absorb the knowledge from teachers. How well you can extract, that is, rather than people giving you, you have to be a taker in such an environment. The initiative taken has taken by the students who wants to learn. Initiation is to be taken by students who want to learn. There is a syllabus which has to be taught. Syllabus jevu kaik hoy ane bhanavanu pan hoy pan etlu j nathi hotu taught in inadequate time and which multiplies into reading beyond the stipulated material. This also is very interesting observation. So the kind of things which are in our syllabus, we normally find that, well, these are not enough. Like if there are 90 days to study, you can't read everything in 90 days. If you sit down to read all original texts, then 90 days is insufficient. It is not at all sufficient. So the syllabus, it always multiplies into reading beyond stipulated time. Literature is highly interdisciplinary category. It comes into something very serious. Then you want to write. You can pick up some of these ideas also. Interdisciplinary category. One can learn about history, culture, politics, sociology, Marxism, feminism, post-colonialism, critical theory, literary theory, structuralism, post-structuralism, and several other isms. For a person who genuinely wants to study literature, the field is fatally vast and deep. It is fatally vast and deep. There is an infinite stream of knowledge. To satisfy an unquenchable thirst that yearns to know more without knowing why it wants to know more. So if you have that hunger, then unquenchable things are there in BA program, MA program, in literature classes. There is no end to that. And you don't know why, because there is meaninglessness of everything. Ultimately, you are taught that, well, everything is meaningless. Your degree is meaningless. Your education is meaningless still. So ultimately, you narrow down to those things. The biggest challenge which emerges in the problem of telos, which means purpose or end, aim of something, in Greek term used often in literary discourses, teleology, work done towards a grand conclusion, the question that begins to haunt one is that of having an objective, which what is one to do and why is one to do, what is the purpose? This, and you don't find an exact answer to any of those things. You are more confused into questions. Then people say that, well, keep on asking questions. You have no answer, but you should keep on asking questions. This dilemma arises out of the education one receives when one studies literature. Starting from Deacons, fact and fancy are distinguished. Then one reads the Victorian realists who highlight the reality of modern life, followed by Russian nihilists who doubt the realness of life. Finally, modernism and existentialism question language and doubt meaning. When one is wondering what to do, Samuel Beckett delivers the final blow and declares, nothing to be done. See how beautifully incorporated what is it to study literature. This text, lots of text that you study, and you can think of all this text and make a chain of the things, and you can conclude, you can amalgamate all those things there. I remember, I think Bhumi Joshi has written a very interesting poem incorporating all these things, the syllabus text, and it was very interesting. If you can get that, you can share that with everybody also. But that was one of the attempts to write in a similar way. And that was very poetic also. It was very interestingly poetic. And a couple of other students also tried to give a poetic expression to this prose write-up. This is a prose. You can select that also. You can have a dialogues also. If you want to have a dramatic, then you can write this, how literature saved me, in form of dialogues. One person asking, another answering, and a kind of a conversation. Or you can write a poem. Also, poem, couple of them have tried. Drama, nobody has tried. And so that can be an idea which you can pick up as a style if you want to, when you want to write. A student of literature is taught to doubt order. Student of literature is taught to doubt order. Hegel and Marx tell him that teleology and grand design are to be opposed. Structuralism and Foucault say ideologies are biased, and the words that one speaks, the institutions one works under, are all to be doubted as systems of control and suppression. The result is a lack of orderliness. The student oscillates between romance and reality, order and anarchy. Now, if this is the Delhi University doing, this is exactly what you are also learning. So now I think you get satisfied with what we are learning is actually what literature students are going to do. Any doubt that remained in your mind, that why are we talking about always resistance, always question the power, why never we take a side in favor of these people? Well, literature nowhere happens in that way. Literature people nowhere is doing or supposed to do. That if you do that, we are cheating with the students. We are cheating with the students if you don't teach them in a proper way of thinking, understanding, looking at the world also. Existential angst is a term often thrown around to describe the young adult. He is supposed to struggle with the meaning of life. Young adult is supposed to struggle with the meaning of life. Is life worth living? What to do? What to be? How to be? To be or not to be? Lots of those things which are hovering in the air. And many times the young adults are still not understanding all these things, not understanding that. Why are we forced to think also? Sukam pan vicharvu. સુકામ વિચારવું જ જોઈએ. આ મજાની જિંદગી છે, જીવીએ. સુકામ વિચારવું, એ જે પ્રશ્નમાં હોય ત્યાં હથોડા છાપ, કેટલા બધા પ્રશ્નો એમના મસ્તિષ્ક ઉપર જીકવામાં આવતા હોય. ધ સ્ટુડન્ટ હેઝ એન એફિનિટી ટુ આસ્ક હિમસેલ્ફ ધીઝ ઇવન ધો હી રિયલાઇઝિસ હી ડઝન્ટ ઓથેન્ટિકલી સ્ટ્રગલ વિથ એક્ઝિસ્ટેન્શિયલ એંગ. એને એમ થાય કે ના, મને તો આવી કોઈ બેચેની છે જ નહીં, તો અહીંયા બેચેની ઊભી કરો એવું કહેવામાં આવે. કેમ તમે બેચેન નથી? ધેટ યુ હેવ ટુ આસ્ક યોરસેલ્ફ. So, well, authentically struggle with existential angst is not realized yet. He identifies with the beatnik bumps of Kerouac, the Holden Caulfields, the James Deans and Marlon Brando's, the low lives of and the vagabonds. He scoffs at the elite, the rich and the driven. But he also knows that he isn't actually alienated. He is constantly in a process of growing up, of coming of age, of going from one point to another, of journeying, but unable to locate himself. He is taught to always doubt identity, because identity is a performance. The real self, the person, the personal mission is what has to be arrived at. It is what cannot be arrived at. The journey through to college or for a literature student is an eternal contradiction which must be resolved in under 3 years. Now you can say 5 years here. He begins with uncertainty. He is taught to be uncertain. He begins with uncertainty. He is taught to be uncertain and spends most of his life in an environment of uncertainty. But decisions have to be taken and choices have to be made. To choose from a void of infinity is the irony of student's life. After school, he is told that he is going to enter the real world. Real world now. But what he actually enters is a space of intermediacy. A limbo. A limbo. It is like, what we have this character. What was the name of the king who was sent to the heaven by Parshuram? Trishanku. Trishanku. So, limbo. So, the situation of the literature student is like Trishanku. So in the classroom interaction, there is some altogether a different thing. You go home and the world is totally different. Here you are told to doubt religious practice, and at home there are lots of religious practices that keep on happening. The life is around all those rituals, and you can't escape those kinds of things. So suddenly we are in that Trishanku, that what are we learning and what are we living? It's a life apart, completely apart, completely different life that we live. And then we are in a limbo in between what we study and what we live, completely opposite lives that we confront. So we suddenly find into the position of Trishanku. The Beatles tell him nothing is real, but before he can dismiss it as fancy, he encounters an academic world which enables doubt. The true challenge for the student of English literature is ultimately the old cliche, one of growing up and coming of age. One is growing up and coming of age, and that is very challenging to grow into these things also there. Okay? So this is how we can see. These are very interesting examples. Lots of other links are given on this website, where you find some YouTube video also to see about this. But I think these three examples can give you ample styles of writing, ideas of writing, and from a particular text to the general way of looking literature, I think you will be able to do that. Okay? If any questions, if you have, you can ask right now. If any questions, if you have, you can ask here. Okay? Yes, anybody, any questions? Semester four students, if you have, then you can see that. Yeah. Okay, you got the idea what you are supposed to do? Is it clear in your mind? Your dual task. One is the group activity that you are going to do, and that group activity, and for a particular text you will write as a practice, and then generally about the literature that you are supposed to write. Okay? Okay, if everything is clear and no doubt, no questions in the mind, then we can end our session here.
Sir, everything is clear, but there was one thing that this particular article was mentioning, the conflict of English literature students, that in real world the things are totally different, and in English literature classroom the things are totally different. Like if there is a struggle of idealistic views, like what literature people wants society to behave in a particular way, and society has its own funda of behaving in a particular way. So this idea also is not giving a particular answer to that. It's still in the conflict. So if as a literature student, if we want to behave, like what should be the role of literature student out of literature classroom?
Yeah, okay, just a minute. There was one. Yeah, it's semester one students. So I'm having this class with semester four students, those who have joined later on. For them this instruction. So I'm listening some questions from semester four students, which you won't be able to listen. Yeah? You won't be able to listen. And this task is not for you. It is not for semester one students. It is for semester four students. But as the class is extended, I have put here also live. So it is not compulsory for you to attend. Semester one students, it is not compulsory for you to attend this class. But you can just, if you want to, you can stay here. Or you can join directly the semester four link also. You can join there and you can listen the questions also. So I'm answering to those questions there. Okay? So like there is this practical way of looking that if this is how it is, then how one can live? We have to live with what kind of an ideas and what conveniences we find in the world. And what actually when you do that, what happens is conflict. What happens is conflict. We come in conflict with the people, and that is what we have seen in existentialism, that well, that is how the life is about. You will do whatever, but there will be a kind of a conflict happening in that way there. And until and unless the entire world or everybody in the world do not have a kind of a maturity of looking at life, the life is not going to change, the society is not going to change. So we have to be with the people, and we can have a choice of being like this. Or if we don't want to be like this, we can be like them also. We have that choice. So it is not that, well, I have to forcefully be different. Not necessarily so. If it naturally grows from a literature, then you can't escape living naturally. You can't escape living that naturalness that is there. It is not that, well, I have done BA and MA in English literature. It was told that these people are like this, so I have to be like that. Now, I don't wear that costume over me. I don't wear that mask over me that I have to be like that. It is said that literature study naturally makes people this kind of thinkers, naturally. So it is when it is natural, you can't escape from that behavior or that thinking pattern. We can't escape. And we know that when I will do that, people will not like it. People will have the conflicts in one or the other. It is a part of life. It is going to happen. There is no escape from that. And then you start living with those things. You start living. Well, you have your way of living, doing the things. I have my way of doing the things. I will allow you to do what you want to do. You please allow me what I want to do. You don't say that, well, you think in this way. You have your own way. I better have my own way of living a life, and then people keep on living together in a similar way also there. So one thing is does it happen naturally or not? Does it happen naturally? And why we share this document? Because we find that when sometimes that happens to us to think in a particular way, and then there are lots of resistance. People say that you should not think in this. You should not do this. You should not behave in this way. This way you have to do. So we find that, well, am I isolated in this? Is this happening only to me? Is this happening only to me? Why that happens to me? That, well, when I see things, I can't escape from thinking like this way. Why I can't? So then we read other people who study literature. And then we read their interviews, their books. And then they say that, well, it happens with everybody. If you study world literature, English literature is a world literature. When you study world literature in a particular way, the way English literatures are taught in most of the places, you are exposed to a philosophy of life. You are exposed to the world religions as such. So you obviously come naturally out of the narrowness of life. You obviously come out from, you can't see that, well, this religion is the greatest, is the best. You say, no, everything is stupid. Everything has the wonderful stories around those kinds of things. You can't get anyway swayed away by any of those beautiful quotes, either in Sanskrit or in Urdu or Arabic or in English language. You find, well, fine, these are the things which are told. But that has to happen naturally. Naturally, if it happens, then. But the point that it happens with most of the people who genuinely study English literature, I say again, English literature, it may not perhaps happen with the people who study Sanskrit literature or Hindi literature or Gujarati literature or any other regional literature. I don't know. I have not read those people talking in a similar way or writing about it in a particular way. I have not read across. If I come across, then I can say. Many of the Gujarati thinkers were quite under the influence of English literature. So Suman Shah and many, that school of people, they have brought lots of those ideas in Gujarati literature. And so Gujarati literature had been very experimenting, and lot many good things have happened in Gujarati literature also because of that meeting of the people. So all these people were very good in English language. They studied English literature also and brought in those ideas. So if you will say, like the Suman Shah example I gave, many other, Chandrakant Bakshi, again, a very interesting person. Then Babu Suthar, for example, if you see, he's a Gujarati teacher, but he's open to world literature. He's open to, and then you can say his thinking is very different. He thinks in a much different way. If you read, you know that what is the thinking pattern. That is what naturally happens to, but the point is it has to happen naturally. With the people, people are not going to do so. We have a choice whether should I live the life that the people want to me, or let them live in their own way. Let me have my own Jola and let me have my own Fakiri, the different kind of Jola and different kind of Fakiri. Then the people who are moving in BMW car and say that main to Jola leke aunga, nikal jaunga, different kind of Jola Fakiri. People may have in looking at the literature in different way also. So you see political leader going to some temple suddenly and doing matha teka and doing the prayer when there are lots of resistance going on. So you can't remember Claudius without that. You remember Claudius, and you try to see that very idea with context of Claudius' prayer scene. A very interesting scene that Claudius is a villain and Claudius is praying, and he's praying and telling the god that, well, I am Papi, I am a sinner, I have killed my brother. But I can't escape, and I know my prayers will not reach to you because I am a bad person. You can't escape from connecting and seeing those things. That is natural to that, natural because you do that. So it is not imposed, should not be imposed upon the thing. What is normally imposed upon is that our lifestyle that we have grown, our culture, the home culture, the home religion, that is very much because we have grown for so many years. And it also seems to have happened natural to us, natural thing. And then suddenly we study some different way of living a life, some different way of thinking a life, which is having a tremendous conflict with what we are growing up till 18, 19, 20 years. That's why. And we know that this conflict will happen to anybody who is thinking with them. This conflict will happen that, well, I have grown up till 20 years with this. Now suddenly something new is coming. What is this? And that's why we used to tell that what is difficult is unlearning. Unlearning and relearning is the most challenging. And Alvin Toffler said this, that the problem of 21st century will not be learning, but it will be unlearning and relearning. And that is obviously very tough. It is not that easy. And we understand that when we are children, we have to grow with those things which are for the children. There are toys for the children. We are supposed to play with those toys. We are supposed to do dingla potia, and we are supposed to have marriage of dingli with dinglo. And that is a very beautiful world that we keep on playing. Those games, Andhra Patani Ramata Pre Rammani Hoy, Andhra Pato Ramta Hoy, Thappo Ramta Hoy, Pakadam Dao Ramta Hoy, lot many different kinds of games we play. But Mota Thaye Pati Apre Samaj Andhra Pato Suche. So a birthday party wanted Kalago, Andhra Pato to Ache. Ato blind man's buff, Chato, Atobo Moti Ramat Chandra Pato, Atapan Barpon Tiapan Sikhadam Avelu Hutu, Kabadi Ramotobo Mahatwan is a Mota Thaso Kerabo Kamlax. કોઈ થપ્પો કરી જશે, તમારો ખબર નહીં હોય, તમારે થપ્પો કરી આવવો પડશે, પકડમ દાહમાં પકડવા પડશે, નહીતર તમે આઉટ થઈ જશો. સો ધીસ ઇઝ ધ લાઈફ. ધેર આર ગ્રેટ લાઈફ લેસન્સ ઇન ઓલ ધોઝ સ્ટોરી. બટ મોટા થઈને હજી આપણે આંધ્રો પાટો જ રમીએ તો આપણે બાળકો જ છે. એ ત્યારે રમવાની હતી, હવે એમના મેસેજ લેવાના હતા જીવનમાં. એન્ડ ધેન વી હેવ ટુ, સો વી હેવ ટુ અનલર્ન ધોઝ થિંગ્સ, એન્ડ ધેન વી હેવ ટુ રીલર્ન ધ થિંગ્સ અબાઉટ લાઈફ. દેટ ઇઝ વેર ઇટ ઇઝ. Conflict is necessary. It is necessary, and people will have to think. Literature people can have their justifications in a far better way than other people can give. They can give a justification on everything because they have a command over language. They have command over thinking also. Clarity of thinking is there. So you can justify, well, everything that you want to justify also. So if you have a debate, nobody can beat you in the debates. If you have any kind of argument with anybody, yeah, you remain unbeatable, and suddenly people will become angry on you. We have seen that video last year. If you remember the video, Sadhuji is sitting and then the lady is asking the question, and then that Sadhu became angry. Now when people become angry, you have to smile. You have to smile and say, well, I have won, because now the person do not have any argument to argue with me. So the person becomes angry. So that is what you can see when people debate around the things also. And you can easily make people angry around you. You can easily make people angry around you also. So that is there. So unlearning, relearning is a part. When we grow, we have to start living something and acquiring something. Yesterday only I had a talk with one another friend, and I was talking, and this metaphor came in the mind, and that was about snake. Snake. You know, સર્પ એમની કાંચરી મૂકે, થોડા વર્ષ સમય થાય એટલે એની ચામડી એ ઉતારી દે, એની રીતે કાંચરી, એની જે આપણે કહીએ એ આખી કાંચરીમાંથી પેઇનફુલી બહાર નીકળે સર્પ. એકદમ ઇટ ઇઝ અ પેઇનફુલ પ્રોસેસ સર્પ માટે, એ બહુ દુઃખ દે, આખી ચામડી ઉતારીને બહાર. અને કાંચરી આપણા માટે સુકનની વસ્તુ, ઘણા લોકો લઈને આવે ઘરમાં ટીંગાડી રાખે કે આ સુકનની વસ્તુ છે. હવે સુકન એટલે કારણ કે એમાં પેઇન છે, એગની, કોઈ પણ વસ્તુમાં પેઇન એગની હોય, પસીનો હોય, કોઈની મહેનત હોય, એ હંમેશા સુકનિયાર વસ્તુ જ હોય. ઘોડાની નાળ પણ લોકો સુકનિયાર ગણે, ઘોડાની નાળ, હોર્સ શૂ. પાલિતાણા જાઓ તો લોકો વેચતા હોય છે ઘોડાની નાળ, કે લોકો લગાડો તમને યુ વિલ ફાઇન્ડ કે આ તો બહુ, કારણ કે એમાં મહેનત છે ઘોડાની, ઘોડાની મહેનત છે. એટલે જ્યાં પણ તમારો પસીનો હોય, મહેનત હોય, એ બધી જ વસ્તુ સુકનિયાર વસ્તુ છે, એ બધી જ વસ્તુ બહુ પવિત્ર છે. તમે બહુ મહેનત કરી હોય અને તમારી ડિગ્રી જે આવી હોય તે ડિગ્રી પણ સુકનિયાર છે, એ પણ સુકનિયાર વસ્તુ છે. યોર ડિગ્રી, યોર ડોક્યુમેન્ટ, યોર મેડલ, દેટ ઓલ ઓલસો ઇઝ, ઇફ યોર હાર્ડ વર્ક ઇઝ ધેર, હાર્ડ વર્ક દેટ ઇટ બીકમ. એટલે સર્પની કાંચરી મૂકે, પેઇનફુલ પ્રોસેસ, દેટ ઇઝ વોટ ઇઝ ફોર એવરીથિંગ. આપણે પણ આપણે પણ આપણી ચામડી ઉતારતા જઈએ છીએ. વી ઓલ્સો ડુ ધેટ. આપણે નવી સ્કીન આવે છે દર વખતે, પણ એ દેખાતી નથી. આપણે સર્પની જેમ આખે આખી કાંચરી ઉતારી શકતા નથી. નહીતર આપણે આ 5 વર્ષનો હતો ત્યારની કાંચરી, આ 8 વર્ષની કાંચરી, આ 12 વર્ષની કાંચરી આપણે મ્યુઝિયમ બનાવ્યા હોત અને ફોટોગ્રાફ પાડીને આપણે ફેસબુકમાં શેર કરતા હોત કે આ કાંચરી ઉતારી. આપણે ત્યાં ખરે છે સ્કીન, ઇટ ઇઝ નોટ લાઈક સ્નેક. બટ ધ પ્રોસેસ ઓફ નેચર ઇઝ ધીસ ઓનલી, દેટ વી હેવ ટુ સ્ક્રેપ ઓફ ઓલ્ડ આઈડિયાઝ. We have to scrap off and we have to acquire new things. That is what the nature is all about. That is how it is naturally true also, that we have to keep on living what we have acquired in childhood when we are at adult age, and then we grow into the old age, then whatever we had for the adulthood, that also we have to live. Je mahatvakanksha ambitions atyare hoy ke આ પાસ કરીને પછી આઈ વિલ ડુ ધીસ, આઈ વિલ ડુ દેટ, આઈ વિલ ડુ ધીસ જોબ, દેટ આઈ વિલ ડુ નોટ મેન. પણ એ 50-60 વર્ષે પછી એ ન ચાલે, પછી એ બધું ક્યારે મૂકી દેવું પડે. દેન યુ ગો ઇન્ટુ ધ ડિફરન્ટ ફેઝ, કાઇન્ડ ઓફ અ થિંગ. સો દેટ ઇઝ હાઉ ઇટ બીકમ્સ ઇન્ટરેસ્ટિંગ ટુ ઓબ્ઝર્વ અબાઉટ હાઉ વી સી ધ કોન્ફ્લિક્ટ દેટ વી આર સ્ટડીંગ એન્ડ વોટ ઇઝ અવર રિયલ લાઈફ સિચ્યુએશન્સ બેક હોમ. હાઉ દેટ બીકમ્સ conflicting, obviously, without doubt, it is very conflicting for everybody as such. Yes, any other observations or questions?
Sir, so far as this outside class discussion is concerned, and as a student of literature, we are having more than 5 years of experience with literature. So the only solution I see that we have to keep all this learning with ourselves throughout the life. And on the basis of those learning we are going to get from here and in upcoming days, so that will be the only helpful tool to fight with the outside society or the outside world.
Yes, it is always a process. That is like, and now imagine if you were in school and some teacher might have come and asked you to do this activity and told you that write an essay about what literature you are. So you are studying literature from very early years, very early. There was always a Gujarati paper or English paper where there were poems, were there, short stories were there. So it was always there. But nobody perhaps told us in the school days to think about this in that way. Maybe if you will become a school teacher, you will do that. If you will remember this, then you will say, well, let me tell the students to do some think about literature and life, about their how it happened. Then if you have done that 5 years or 7 years back, today again you are doing, then you will say, after 10 years again you will think. You may go back to your blog and you find, well, I have done this 10 years back, today let me think what happened in the next 10 years. Next 10 years you might have seen new web series, you might have seen new cinema, you might have read new literatures, and you might have been very busy with life also, you might have become parents also, and you might have found that, well, there is no time now, there is really no time for literature, television, web series, this, and then again after 10 years you look back and see, and then again you say, well, this is how it goes. 10 years down the line, after that also you can think, and then again also you can do. So it is always a process that keeps on moving, going on and on. And we can do that with everything in life, not only literature. Here we do it with literature, but we can do that with everything that we do in our life, that how those things are shaping our lives, how those things are shaping our lives in a significant way. So earlier I used to think that, well, so many subjects in schools, history, geography, civics, social studies, mathematics, why these things are necessary, and when you want to do only one, why don't you teach only that? So if you ask a student, what do you want to be? And student says, I want to become a sports person. Then let us have only PT period only. Let us throughout the 8 hours, he will play on the ground only, nothing else. But these are child's imagination. These are children. You can't do that, because a player also is required to study mathematics. Because even if you are a footballer, you should know what is the curve. When you hit a ball, there is a banana spin. But how the banana spin happened, there is a geometry in that also. So everywhere it is, if you spin a ball, if you are a cricketer or you hit a ball, that physics is everywhere. Physics is everywhere. So that is how reading all those things are very important. If you don't know the digits, then today without digits, we can't do anything. Lots of calculations of percentage. When you ask students, calculate your percentage, and the students say, I don't know. We ask, what are your marks in mathematics? You say 100 out of 100. You got 100 out of 100 in maths, but you don't know how to calculate percentage. Then what is the use of those 100 marks? What is the use of that? That questions we have to keep on asking in schools also. That when you have studied this, you got full mark, but can you do this? Can you put a candle in a glass and then tell me that why the candle will not have a fire? Can you do that? You put a candle in this, and then why the candle will extinguish if there is no air? Then you know that there is no oxygen. Fire is all about oxygen. It is oxygen, then only there is a fire. So then you find an answer that if there is anywhere a fire, you have to bring in something where there is no oxygen. So then the fire will not live. Fire will die. Agni koi dev che ke rakshas che. To ene bhagadva mate tamare CO2 lavu pade. CO2 લાવો એટલે અચાનક એ રાક્ષસ ભાગી જશે તો જો એમાં રાક્ષસની મિથ પણ આવી ગઈ એમાં વિજ્ઞાન પણ આવી ગયું લોટ મેની થિંગ્સ કમ ટુગેધર ઇન ઓલ ધોઝ થિંગ્સ સો એવરીથિંગ ધેટ વી સ્ટડી ઇઝ વેરી મીનિંગફુલ એવરીથિંગ ઇઝ મીનિંગફુલ બ્રોડ બેઝડ એજ્યુકેશન ઇઝ રિયલી યુઝફુલ બટ હાઉ ડુ વી સી દેટ હાઉ ડુ વી સી દેટ સો મેની ટાઈમ્સ વી ફીલ કે સ્કૂલમાં સિવિક્સ બરાબર ભણાવવામાં આવતું નથી અને એટલે આપણી પાસે સિવિક સેન્સ નથી રહેતું વી ડોન્ટ હેવ સિવિક સેન્સ We talk a lot about common sense, but we don't talk about civic sense. એક નાગરિક તરીકે મારે શું કરવું જોઈએ, કઈ રીતે ચોખ્ખાઈ રાખવી જોઈએ, કઈ રીતે નિયમોનું પાલન કરવું જોઈએ, કઈ રીતે હેલ્મેટ પહેરવી જોઈએ. જેમ અત્યારે બધા કે માસ્ક પહેરે છે, કારણ કે 1000 રૂપિયા દંડ છે એટલે પહેરે છે. હેલ્મેટ તો હજી નથી પહેરતા. 3-3 લોકો એક બાઇકમાં બેઠા હોય, 3 માસ્ક પહેર્યા હોય, હેલ્મેટ કોઈએ ન પહેર્યું, 3 બેઠા હોય, એટલે આપણે આ કેટલા નિયમો તોડીને એક નિયમનું પાલન કરે છે આ વ્યક્તિ. 3 લોકો કેટલા નિયમો તોડી અને એક નિયમનું પાલન કરે છે, માસ્ક પહેરવાનું. બટ અધર રૂલ્સ, વોટ અબાઉટ હેલ્મેટ, વોટ અબાઉટ નોટ સિટિંગ 3 પીપલ ઓન અ બાઇક. સો ધીસ ઓલ્સો, પણ એ સેન્સ જ નથી. તમને જોવો તો તમને અજુગતું લાગે કે આ આવું ના હોય. તમે એને કહેવા જાવ તો તમને 3 ભેગા થઈને મારે, એ 3 ભેગા થઈને તમને ધીમી નાખે. તમે એને શીખામણ આપવા જાવ, યુ જસ્ટ હેવ ટુ ઓબ્ઝર્વ એન્ડ સી દેટ. યુ હેવ ટુ જસ્ટ ઓબ્ઝર્વ એન્ડ હેવ a wry smile, a dark humor you can get from the life. Nothing else you can do. But many people, they understand civics, and then you don't have to impose rules. Then you don't have to impose rules. People understand that, well, this is what we are supposed to do. So in the other class, I don't know whether those students are there, because they also are listening right now. I think most of them have left now. There was this case of a student where I asked that, where were you? Katla divasthi hajarad nathi. તો કે હું જીપીએસસીની તૈયારી કરું છું. નાઉ સી, વેન યુ વોન્ટ ટુ પ્રિપેર ફોર જીપીએસસી, ધેન ડુ એક્સટર્નલ એમએ એન્ડ બીએ. તો કે મેં બીએ માં આમ જ કર્યું હતું. તો નાઉ સી, વેન યુ વોન્ટ ટુ ડુ અ ગવર્મેન્ટ, વેન ઇફ યુ બીકમ અ કલેક્ટર, તમે કલેક્ટર પણ બની જાઓ, પછી કરશો શું? ખોટું જ કરશો, કારણ કે ખોટા રસ્તે જ ચાલ્યા છો. કોલેજે ગયા વગર તમે ડિગ્રી લીધી છે, એ તો ખોટું જ કર્યું છે. અને હવે એમએ પણ એમ જ કરવું છે તમારે. તમારે સ્કોલરશીપ લેવી છે, સ્કોલરશીપ તમને એમએ માટે છે, જીપીએસસી માટે નથી. તોય તમારે સ્કોલરશીપ લેવી છે, આવું નથી, અભ્યાસ કરવો, પાછું ગવર્મેન્ટની નોકરી કરવી છે. સો પહેલેથી જ મનમાં તો ખરાબ જ વિચાર છે. તો હવે એ કલેક્ટર બને તો એ ખોટું જ કામ કરશે. તો હાઉ વિલ વી ટીચ સિવિક સેન્સ? દેટ વોટ એવર યુ ડુ, દેર આર રૂલ્સ ટુ બી ફોલોડ, એન્ડ યુ હેવ ટુ ફોલો ધ રૂલ્સ, એન્ડ ધેન યુ હેવ ટુ થિંક ઓફ બ્રેકિંગ ધ રૂલ્સ. આપણે તો રૂલ ફોલો નથી કરવા, પહેલા તો રૂલ બ્રેક કરી નાખીએ બધા. આપણે શીખા છે, ફૂકોએ કીધું છે કે રૂલ બ્રેક કરો, પણ ફર્સ્ટ ફોલો ધ રૂલ્સ. Some rules are good, should be followed by everybody. Then there are some rules which are to be questioned, which are to be. So then you understand, well, which rule to be questioned, which rule to not to be followed. એટલે કોઈ અચાનક રાતે જાગીને કહે કે ચલો બજાવો થાળી, તો એમ ના કરાય. That you can understand that this is not fair. This is nowhere, anywhere that you can do. તો ક્યાં કયું કરવું અને કોનું ન કરવું, that also is a common sense. But many school topics also you can think, when you think of this, that what in school had really meaningfully helped you in shaping your life, in shaping your life, which subject or how, and how, if that topic was taught in a different way, you might be thinking about that subject, about life, in a completely different way. How that also can be questioned when you think of that. Okay, any further questions? Yeah.
So on a larger scale, if we want to think that the world right now requires English language at the top priority, and then by giving the exceptional ideas about language, we can convey our core message that this is how literature is to be read, this is how various things to be read in a different way. So the the core idea is to teach language in a proper way, and how English language is to be read in which manner. So that thing we need to focus upon in upcoming days also.
Yes, but not only language. Along with language, there is lot many other thing that comes. That is literature. Literature, English literature comes with lots of philosophy of other thing. That is very important. See, that's why when if you remember this talk by Stephen Krashen, he was making that point, that well, English language is fine. You will be very good user of language, but what are you going to do with that language? You may fool people with your mastery of language, which you are not supposed to do. Or when somebody is fooling the people, you will be easily fooled by the master of language. So that sense also we have to cultivate, that language is something great manipulator. It can it can make us emotionally susceptible to do several things. That is the power of language. That also I have to understand, that when the language comes with a powerful flow, with a beautiful rhetorics, I may be blinded towards reality or truth also. Towards reality and truth, that may happen through language. So knowing language is knowing this, that is the philosophy behind that, not only the mastery of one language, or we can say any language which is global language, that should be mastered. If you want to see language, then when you write or think, if you speak a word English language, then people will say, well, no, it is not good idea. But you have to say global language. You have to use a better word. Now, when you say global language, people will not question, because global is still a better word than English. English has a lot of resistance, nationalistic, and as Adiga also writes that. So global. So you say that which language helps you travel the entire globe? Your idea to travel the entire globe. Then you can say, well, English. Then fine. Then you then let the other person say English language. We will say global, whichever language. If Gujarati is global, I don't have any problem in speaking in Gujarati language. It has to be global. It should be understood by Marathis. It should be understood by Assamese. It should be understood by Malayali. Then I can talk of somebody living in China or in America. But first, even in India, whether that language is understood by the people or not, question we have to ask. The Gujarati people may not like this. Gujarati people will, their sentiments will get hurt when we say this. But then there is a truth. That is the reality of those things. So, but global can be a better word. So we become, we can understand whether this language has this effect. You can say, when you use language, what will be the effect of that language? So then we can change a word. We can change a word in a better way. So normally we don't say that you are ignorant. આપણે કેવું હોય તો આપણે કોઈને એમ ના કહીએ કે યુ આર ઇગ્નોર, વી સે યુ આર ઇનોસન્ટ. યુ આર ઇનોસન્ટ એટલે પેલા નહીં મજા આવે કે હું તો નાના બાળક જેવો નિર્દોષ છું, કે અમને એમ કીધું કે તમે તો બહુ નિર્દોષ છો એટલે તમને લોકો છેતરી જાય. એમ ના કહે કે તું મૂર્ખ છે એટલે લોકો છેતરી જાય છે, તું મૂર્ખ છે એક નંબરનો એટલે તને લોકો છેતરી જાય. એમ ના કહે કે તો તમે તો બહુ નિર્દોષ છો કે તમને લોકો, એટલે પેલાને મજા આવે કે વાહ હું બહુ નિર્દોષ છું. ઇટ્સ જસ્ટ ધ ગેમ ઓફ વર્ડ્સ, ઇટ્સ નથિંગ બટ ધ ગેમ ઓફ વર્ડ્સ. સો વી અન્ડરસ્ટેન્ડ દેટ, કે કોઈને હર્ટ કરવા હોય તો આ શબ્દ વાપરો, કોઈને પંપાળવા હોય તો આ શબ્દ વાપરો, કોઈને મલમપટ્ટી, કોઈ ઈજાગ્રસ્ત થઈને આવ્યું છે તો આપણે મલમપટ્ટી કરવી પડે, અને બહુ ઘમંડ લઈને આવ્યો હોય તો આપણે એને થોડા ઉજરડા પાડવા પડે. કોઈ ઘમંડ લઈને આવ્યો તો એને ઉજરડા પાડી આપણે ભાષાના નખ ભરાવવા પડે, અને કોઈ ઓલરેડી ઉજરડાઈને આવ્યું હોય તો આપણે ભાષાની મલમપટ્ટી કરીશું. That is language. Any language it can be. Any language which can be. But in English literature, it is not language, but there is a world overview that comes through English literature. That is very important. Because the literature of the entire world gets translated into English language. And so you get an exposed to all those ideas. See, how many texts that you are studying is originally written in French language? Had it been only in French, we might not have studied Waiting for Godot. We might not have studied this Black Skin, White Mask. Many philosophers, writers who originally wrote only in French, and then we won't do that let us study French and then read their ideas. English literature syllabus is very global. It is in true sense of world. Now it doesn't mean that other language syllabuses are not there. It is there. Like in our Gujarati department, they do teach very interestingly the global literature. And that they are doing so, that also is a good department that keeps on working. But you don't find the same kind of thing happening throughout India with regional language departments. Not all, but some are very good. Even Baroda has a good Gujarati department. This also is good department. They study global literature in variety of ways also. So then you find openness among the people. The people are open-minded in many things when they look at those things. Yeah, okay. So any other further observations or any questions? Okay, so then I hope you got this idea now. Okay, what is literature review we have seen earlier, and now today we have seen how to write about how literature shaped me. And so you will be able to do your task properly now. Okay.